Yes, I'm Batman.
I'm Batman.
I'm Batman, Alfred.
I'm Batman.
I am Batman!
I'm Batman.
I'm Batman.
Greetings, Bat family. Welcome back to Holy BatCast, brought to you by Real Fans for Real Movies. Please visit our website, holybatcast.com. It's your one-stop shopping for all Holy BatCast, so go there. You can also find us all over social media, all the places you spend your time online, on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram, and on YouTube. Just search for Holy BatCast and you will find us. We are also on Patreon, so if you are a fan of the show, would like to help support the show on Patreon, please join us over there at patreon.com/holybatcast. It would certainly mean the world to us, and so along those lines, I gotta give another shout out to our latest patron, Mr. Christopher R. Ford. So Christopher, thank you so much for doing that. We really do appreciate it. We couldn't do it without you guys. And Christopher, it is a pleasure. So thank you again so much. And again, if anybody would like to join the team, go to patreon.com/holybatcast, just like Christopher. We are part of the Real Fans Podcast Network. So if you want to check out some of the other shows there, you can do that at rf4rm.com. As always, I'm your host, Andy DeGenova, and if you'd like to follow me on my non-Batman-related adventures, you can do that on Instagram and on Twitter. It's just my name, Andy DeGenova. Now, this episode, we'll catch up on a little bit of news, but really, we're going to focus on you, our friends, our listeners, our family. We're going to answer all your questions in the Wayne Manor Mailbox. Joining me for that is not Jamie Drewley, who is sitting in a pumpkin patch waiting for the arrival of the Great Pumpkin. And it's not Brendan Lowe, who's sitting in the middle of a dark and dry field waiting for the arrival of the Great Koala. It is another friend of the show who you haven't heard in a little while, but I thought it was high time he got back. It's from Dark Tower Radio and a huge Batman fan. It's Jeremy Lloyd. Hey, Jeremy.
Hey, thanks for having me back.
No problem. On the last episode, when Brendan joined, he mentioned that, you know, you were another one of the bench warmers. And I was like, that's true. And it's been a minute. So let me see if I can get Jeremy on for this next episode.
Well, I do want to let all the Bat fans out there know, although I am no Jamie and I am no Brendan, I do live near a lot of corn and I do frequent the Outback Steakhouse. So.
I mean, the Bloomin' Onion. What more do you need?
Exactly.
Well, glad that you could join. And yeah, folks out there listening in internet land, you are probably getting this episode a little bit early. But I told you guys, the schedule's all messed up for October, so there's been gaps, there's been weird days that it's been released, and this time, another weird day that it's been released came out a little bit early. That's because I'm about to embark on my annual trip down for Halloween hijinks in Florida, and so I wanted to get you guys an episode before I left town, because once I am on that airplane, I'm not going to think about all this other stuff, all my real life, going to ignore all of it for a full week. So I wanted you to have something in your feed so you don't forget about me while I go enjoy Halloween, and you guys go enjoy Halloween, and then we'll all come back together in November and talk about whatever's happening then. So that's the reason, but I wanted you to have something. So thank you for your understanding with the craziness of this past month, but thanks for sticking with us. We do appreciate it. It is the Halloween season, so happy Halloween to everybody. It's Halloween week. I know that usually Jamie and I try to put together a Halloween episode of sorts. As is everything this month, it's just been crazy, and we haven't, unfortunately, been able to do that, but there's still stuff to talk about. So if we're talking scary, one of the scariest things that's happened recently is we learned that the production on The Flash might be delayed. So it's funny because a couple episodes ago, one of our friends, Philip Barker, wrote in. He goes, hey, what do you think the next movie to go into production after Birds of Prey will be? And I was like, oh, The Flash. Seems like The Flash is ready to go. And I should have never said that. I jinxed it. I screwed us all because I swear a day later, Variety reports that, oh, the Flash movie is going to get delayed another year. They're not going to do production until 2019, which means the movie wouldn't be out until 2020 or 2021.
Maybe it was 2021.
I mean, that's what it says here. It says The movie was scheduled to begin filming in early 2019, has been pushed back to late 2019. And this is according to Variety. Variety is a little more legit than some of the other places you might get your rumors. And it says it was to give time for more work on the script. There was also the reason given that Ezra Miller wanted, like, there were scheduling issues with Ezra Miller because of Fantastic Beasts. So I guess that means he survives the new movie, I guess.
I was thinking the same thing when I read that.
if there's that. So apparently that was part of the reason. But it says that there's no official release date. In fact, the movie has still not officially been greenlit. It's still in development. But it seems like the shooting won't be till late 2019, which means we might not actually see it in theaters. I would say late 2020 at the earliest, but more likely 2021, which is a bummer. I'm bummed about this. Mm. I was looking forward to Ezra Miller's Flash solo film, and it seemed like things were going well, and now another delay.
Well, I mean, I guess you can't fault WB for, you know, putting Fantastic Beast ahead of the Flash. I mean, that is a franchise that is bringing in a lot of money over there at Warner Brothers. So, I mean, if that is the only reason that this is happening, I mean, I guess I can't fault them for that.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, I was with you. Ezra Miller is one of the one things I really enjoyed about Justice League, you know.
He was my favorite.
I mean,
I know not everyone loved him. I did.
For all the little, you know, nitpicks and stuff I could have with that movie, I mean, I enjoy it for what it is. And, you know, he was a big reason for that. I didn't know what to expect with his Flash coming into that movie. And I really enjoyed him. And I thought, I definitely wanted to see, you know, a solo film with that version of the Flash. I mean, I hope that, you know, the only reason for this other delay, or I guess for another delay, because we know it's been delayed a couple times, is, you know, this scheduling conflict. And I hope that it's nothing, you know, more than that. But, I mean, we do know that, you know, it seems like the DC Cinematic Universe is kind of pumping the brakes a little bit and, you know, seems like they're reevaluating, taking things a little slowly. I know Jamie on here has talked about, you know, I think a lot of it hinders on Aquaman and Shazam. So I don't know if maybe that's part of it too. I mean, what do you think?
I mean, there's certainly that possibility. I'm hoping that this is really the reason, is they want more time to get it right. They want more time to focus on the script. They need to open up the schedule for Ezra. All that's great. I hope it's true. Yeah, but there's certainly the possibility that they're like, or we wait and see what happens with these next two movies that are definitely in continuity, that are in the shared universe, and let's see what happens with those before we continue committing to in-universe films. That's certainly possible.
Well, I think the other reason that it worries me a little bit, too, is, you know, just with all the stuff with Affleck recently and, you know, and then, you know, all the stuff recently with Cavill, it's like, it almost feels sometimes that they're trying to distance themselves from Justice League and BVS still. You know, even though Aquaman, I mean, is coming out, but, you know, Aquaman was already in production before all this went down. Wonder Woman is a no-brainer, obviously, but it's like this weird limbo, Andy, where it just feels like, you know, they have, like, certain parts of this universe that's working really well, and some parts, you know, they just don't know what to do with anymore. And I'm just at a loss of words of where we're going to go from here, even with Aquaman and Wonder Woman, if they're really successful. I mean, Wonder Woman, I think, will be fine, but, you know, moving forward, I just don't see where this is going, because I have to wonder, I mean, are we going to just get movies that take place before the Justice League movie in terms of timeline, or are we going to revisit that time period? Because it's just kind of a mess right now.
That's a big question mark, but I mean, Aquaman takes place post Justice League, and so does Shazam. So
yeah, that's true. Shazam does. Yeah, I didn't know Aquaman did.
It does, because he meets Mera for the first time in Justice League.
That's true. Yep. You're
and
right.
In this one, he is off on a globe-trotting adventure with her. So I do think, I mean, obviously they're trying to distance themselves from that movie, but I still think they realize they have a lot of really strong assets in the cast and in the characters. It is odd to be distancing yourself from your two biggies, Superman and Batman. That's odd. But, yeah. I mean, they're committed to Wonder Woman. Right now they're committed to Aquaman. If Aquaman is as good as we think it's going to be, and as successful as it should be, then, you know, they're still in this universe. And then the same thing with Shazam. So I think that, you know, they're committed to it for now, but this delay in the Flash does give them another opportunity to pull a ripcord if they choose to.
Yep.
So we'll see. I mean, I loved Ezra Miller's Flash. I am all for it. And I liked the idea of that going into production early next year. But even the delay of going later next year is still not the, you know, it's not the worst thing ever, you know, instead of early 2019, late 2019, because I heard 2019 and I'm like, oh man, that's so far away. And I went, wait, it's October of 2018. Never mind. That's just a couple months away. Forget it. So the delay is not the end of the world. And if it's truly to make sure that, you know, it's the best it can be, great. Don't rush it. So I'm not freaking out about it. There are definitely conspiracy theories we can have about it, but who knows? So don't waste your energy. We'll see what happens. In the meantime, you know, we'll see what happens with Aquaman. We'll see what happens with Shazam. And then, of course, Wonder Woman 1984. Fortunately, Wonder Woman 1984 is only a year away.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wait. Oh, wait. No, it's not. It was only a year away. It was going to help me next year get over my post-Halloween blues, because it was all set for November 1st of next year. And then they announced this week that that is not the case. They are pushing it back to the summer, June 5th of 2020. So how do you feel about this, Jeremy, before I give my thoughts?
Well, I mean, when I was thinking about it, when I heard about this announcement, I was like, wait a minute, wasn't Wonder Woman, the first Wonder Woman, released in the summer as well? And yeah, it was released in May of 2017. So, I mean, why not, you know, go back to, you know, what was successful before it was released in the summer the last time? It did really well. You know, why not make Wonder Woman 84 another summer movie? You know, I don't know if maybe that fall schedule was, you know, getting full, because I did mention something about the competition, I guess, in that slot. So I don't know if maybe that was something that they were concerned about. But I mean, for me, I think it makes sense. I mean, I'm a big summer movie fan, so if you're going to give me more superhero movies in the summer, I'm all for it.
Yeah, this causes me zero concern. It just makes sense. It's just good business. Coming out November 1st, it still would have done great, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But yeah, the first Wonder Woman became a smash hit the first week of June. Knowing that they'll have this, you know, have this movie that they can just make more money the following summer and get it back to where it belongs is just smart. That's what Gal Gadot put when she's the one who tweeted out the initial announcement, and she said, we're able to put Wonder Woman back to its rightful home on June 5th of 2020, and I really think that's all there is to it. Keep in mind that Wonder Woman 2 was going to be coming out 3 weeks after Joker.
Yeah, that was another thing that made me wonder if that's, you know, part of the reason too, is they didn't want those two overlapping too much.
Yeah, I mean, that's crazy. And yeah, there would have been enough box office for both, but to put two of your DC films right on top of each other like that and then have a huge long gap without until the next one, again, it's smart to separate them out, especially because Joker, it has buzz. You know, however this movie does, or however good this movie ends up being, I think it's going to make money in October. So again, like, I can't fault Warner Brothers for putting Wonder Woman 1984 in a spot where it is the best poised to make the most amount of money and get her back to into the summer. So I don't think there's anything else going on here other than putting the right movie in the right spot to make the maximum amount of money.
Well, yeah, and I mean the delays, you know, with Flash and Wonder Woman, you know, let's be honest, how many of us have been saying, you know, let's pump the brakes, you know, let's slow down a little bit. So I'm all for, you know, spacing these movies out a little further than what we were in the past anyway, just to get a better product out there, you know, better films and, you know, more success with this universe, because, you know, we obviously know some of the characters and stuff are probably going to get rebooted at some point. But you know, I really want to see this thing move forward and get back on both legs and, you know, pick up pace, you know, with success. I mean, that's what I want to see. So if that means, you know, pushing back, you know, release dates and not, you know, getting the internet world into a frenzy with all these movie announcements and stuff that may never happen, I mean, I'm fine with that. You know, take your time, do it right.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's this greedy geek part of me that likes the idea of like going to see the Joker and then three weeks later going to see Wonder Woman 1984. But if I was in Warner Brothers' shoes, I would have done the same thing. Put her back in June. Makes perfect sense. Speaking of Joker, so obviously they're out there shooting. I'm not going to keep reporting on spy photos and stuff like that. You guys can find it if you want to find it. I'd rather just save it for the movie. But we know that Thomas Wayne is a character in this movie, and now we know that Bruce Wayne and Alfred are also going to pop up because they've been cast. So I almost was like, maybe we don't talk about it. Is that spoilery? But I'm like, well, the guys have been cast, so I don't know if that really counts as spoilers. But yeah, they cast a young Bruce Wayne and Alfred. So young Bruce Wayne is going to be played by Dante Pereira Olsen, and Douglas Hodge will be playing Alfred. Thoughts on this?
All of a sudden, that age gap on Gotham isn't that big of a deal, is it, when you look at this one?
That's true. That is true. You got a 40-year-old Joker and a 10-year-old Bruce Wayne.
I don't know, Andy. I have no idea what to make of this movie. I'm excited for it just because I am a big Joaquin Phoenix fan. His movies just always intrigue me. He always does, you know, really interesting roles, and the idea of him playing a Joker has just really intrigued me. I'm not saying it's going to be great. I'm really intrigued by this movie, and, you know, and the announcement of a young Bruce Wayne being cast, like, it just throws even more wrenches in the chain for me, because I have no idea what is going on with this movie or what I'm going to see when I sit down in that seat.
Yeah, I will say, though, when this news came out, my reaction was, well, of course. Like, we've got Thomas Wayne. Are you not going to have a Bruce Wayne? Of course you are. You're not going to have an Alfred? Of course you are. Like, so I just took it as like, yeah, duh. But honestly, it hadn't even crossed my mind, the age difference. I didn't even think twice about it until you said it. And I was like, oh, God, you're right. That's crazy. They're 30 years different. I don't know how that works. I have no idea. But, you know, if nothing else, more aspects of the Batman universe making their way into Joker. So It's interesting. I have no opinions on these two actors. I don't know them. I'm not familiar with them, but no, I'm intrigued. That's the word I use the most when it comes to the Joker film. I'm intrigued by how this is going to play out.
Same.
So something that is always intriguing is Gotham on Fox. And we're marching into the fifth season of Gotham. And we've been on this train the whole time. We're staying on to the bitter end.
Yeah, this final season is for us, right? I mean, we're like the last two guys watching, I think.
Yeah, there's a few of us. So we got our first look in Gotham of Bane, their version of Bane, actor Shane West as Bane in Gotham. And this caused quite a little stir around the internet between fans. So if you've seen the photo, you know what I'm talking about. If you've not seen the photo, he has kind of like a cyborgy chest thing going on with like a leather jacket. And then like a kind of like a gas mask.
I saw people describing it as Bane has a sleep apnea machine attached to him.
Okay, okay. I think I heard people say it was like a Morton Joe's son from Mad Max.
That's a good one.
So I could see that too. But yeah, so we get this look at Bane. And what was your reaction, Jeremy?
I mean, at this point, I mean, like you said, I've been on this journey since the beginning. I think I may have fell off of Gotham for a short period of time. I think during maybe the third season, maybe the second season, I don't remember. But, you know, I got back on it. It was mostly just not having time to watch it. Yeah, this show, nothing surprises me really anymore with this show. I you know, I expect them to just, you know, go crazy with these characters. So, honestly, when I did see the photo, I actually had to read, you know, the article and everything, because I was pretty confused. I didn't know that that was Bane right off the bat when I saw the photos. But
how could you not know that was Bane, Jeremy? That is obviously Bane. Have you never seen Bane before? That's him.
Yeah, well, he didn't have the green skin and the, you know, veins.
Bomb. Bomb.
He didn't have the Raphael, you know, coat and jacket going on.
Yeah, I know.
But yeah, I mean, does it look ridiculous? Yeah. Does it look like the Bane that I'm used to? No. Will I still watch it? Absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, my reaction is like, that's Gotham. I just got to laugh. Like, if you're getting mad about what Gotham is doing to your characters, like, that's still a waste of energy. Yeah. It's Gotham. Come on. What do you expect? What do you expect from Gotham right now? You know what it is. It's been going on for 4 years. You know what you're getting. Either willing to roll with it or you're not. Most of you have already jumped off it. Who cares? Let them do what they want to do. Do I think it looks good? No, not really. Yeah, someone else said, you know, it looks like Anakin Skywalker at the end of Revenge of the Sith. I can see that, you know. Anakin and a Morton Joe had a baby, that kind of thing. So yeah, if you'd have shown me this, would you go, what character is that? I would have never said Bane. I just wouldn't have. I don't think it looks particularly good, but let me say this, even though I don't think it looks good. Number one, it's Gotham. Who cares? Number two, every villain on this show has gone through an evolution.
Mm-hmm.
Every single villain. So if you watch like the very first episode with the Mad Hatter, or the very first episode with Mr. Freeze, or the very first episode with the Scarecrow, they barely looked like themselves either. And then they got there. Mm-hmm. So I'm also not freaking out. I'm not freaking out because, again, it's Gotham. I don't care that much. But I'm also not freaking out because, like, hey, all of these guys have grown into themselves. And I know that we've only got half a season to do it with Bane, but I would not at all be shocked if this is Bane's initial look.
Yeah, that's true. I hadn't even thought about that. You're right. I mean, and, you know, as much as we can critique Gotham, I mean, I think for the most part, me and you have agreed, you know, in the end, I think they've handled the villains pretty well in terms of their looks.
Totally.
You know, once they got them there, you know, so. Yeah, I mean, I would say if you're complaining about this Bane, I would probably say you're not a person who's been watching the show, you know, as much as, you know, people like me and Andy who have been following it, because this shouldn't surprise you. But yeah, I mean, I wouldn't be shocked if we see like an evolution of Bane through this season, and, you know, maybe we do get a fully recognizable comic book accurate Bane in that last episode. I don't know.
I mean, again, I would not be shocked, because that's what they did for Mr. Freeze. That's what they did for Scarecrow. They all got there, but it took a while. And again, you don't have a full season to do it, but you still could do it in a couple episodes.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, we know how they like to rush storylines through the season.
This is true.
So
this is true.
He may only be in like two episodes, so.
But yeah, so for those of you guys who hate it, I get it. I don't blame you. It's not great. But it's Gotham. It's fine. Let them do their thing. It's almost over.
It's almost over.
Yeah, it's almost over. If you hate it, it's almost over. It's fine. There are other things. Watch Titans instead. It's all good. If you do like Gotham, see what happens. We'll see how this develops. But if nothing else, I'll always give props for like, hey, you took a swing. And I respect taking a swing.
I would like to think that maybe you guys will cover the last final season of Gotham on here.
I mean, I'll tell you, like, this is the most I've heard anyone discuss Gotham in a while. So, I mean, at least they made a splash, like the new Jan Brady.
That's true.
So, anyway, we'll see.
I actually forgot that the next season was coming until I saw this.
Surprise.
Oh, yeah. That's still a thing I get to watch here soon. So
we'll see how it goes. But, again, it's Gotham. Don't you worry your pretty little heads about it. There's plenty more to entertain you. But anyway, I think that's a nice little update as far as what's happening in the world of Batman. But what we really want to do is check in with you fine folks. So it is time, without further ado, to crack open the Wayne Manor Mailbox. It's time again
for the Wayne Manor Mailbox. You've got mail.
Derek.
She wrote a letter. You're one hell of a messenger.
This is all Master Wayne.
So I am going to start with Twitter, because I did throw it out there on Twitter, and I got some responses. So I want to address those first, and then we'll go to the actual email box from there. So let me see if I can find your stuff on Twitter and read the questions that we have. Okay, here we go. First question from Brendan Lowe. Brendan Lowe at Lowey 007. His question is this: what's the reason I won't be on this episode? It's a valid question, mostly because the listeners asked us to stop. So, I mean, that's really on you. All right, this next one is from Ryan Lower. It says, what would be your pitch for a Batman Halloween special? No limits, no restrictions, anything goes. Ooh, Ryan, I like where your head is at. Jeremy, what do you think? A Batman Halloween special?
Are we talking like an animated feature? Or
whatever. I don't know.
Whatever.
No limits, no restrictions. It says it right here.
Ooh, I mean, I've been dying to see a good Batman Scarecrow story brought to life in a good, like, a feature film. I've also been waving the flag for a Long Halloween adaptation. Don't know if that's ever going to happen. So, I mean, I'm all for it. I know, you know, we've messaged before where I'm like, you know, we definitely need more Batman Halloween stories, because, I mean, come on, it's Batman. That's a character that's made for Halloween, you know, for, you know, the villains that he has in his rogues gallery. Like, come on, like, we need more Batman Halloween stories. So, yeah, I mean, I would love to see a good Scarecrow story. And yeah, I mean, give me the Long Halloween, finally.
All right. Well, here's my pitch that I just made up as you were talking. It's got to be Scarecrow. It's got to be Scarecrow. And yeah, I'm going to say it's a 30-minute Halloween special, animated special. And at the beginning of the special, Batman does get doused with Scarecrow's fear toxin on Halloween night. And then, while under the influence of the fear toxin, he has to get to the other side of Gotham to stop the Scarecrow from doing who knows what. I don't know. You know, maybe he's got Alfred held hostage, maybe he's about to unleash the fear gas on everyone, I don't know. But Batman has to traverse all of Gotham while under the influence of the fear toxin. So Gotham, which is already a nightmarish place, is transformed from the way Batman sees it into like a Halloween version of Gotham. And he has run-ins with the rest of his rogues gallery, but like super amped up, exaggerated Halloween-y versions because of the fear toxin.
I like it.
That's my pitch. I just made it up.
Why not just have it take place on Halloween?
I said that. I said on Halloween night.
Oh, okay.
On Halloween night. All right, next message here is from James Mullins, who was kind enough to send me the Swamp Thing Halloween special from Walmart. So, James, thank you for that. He says, how would you guys feel about a Halloween arc of a Batman comic where Condiment King holds all the pumpkin spice in Gotham hostage? I think there's another, that's another Halloween special.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think that's going to be my Halloween pitch right there. Let's do that.
Yeah, maybe that's the B story. and Batgirl is trying to save the pumpkin spice in Gotham because she's more into the pumpkin spice lattes.
There we go. We could do like they did with the Killing Joke. That'll be like the side story that leads into the story that you pitched.
Yeah. The dogs agree.
There we go.
All right. This is from Batman Fan Deutschland. It says, have you guys read The Kitchen? Excited for the film? I'm not familiar with The Kitchen.
I don't know what that is.
What the heck is The Kitchen?
My dog is just dying to chime in.
I have no idea.
No idea what that is.
I'm sorry, friend. I don't know what that is. apologies. I'm not sure. Unless that was a typo, maybe?
I mean...
Because what would be the film?
I'm bringing up a show on the Food Network called The Kitchen.
Oh, well, I have no idea. I'm sorry, man. All right, next question is from Julian Chan. It says, what's your favorite image of Batman? Like, specific. Like, Alex Ross's Batman looking over the city. Jim Lee's Batman and Robin swinging over the city. Batman on the Gargoyle in Justice League, etc. Favorite image of Batman? Jeremy?
That's like putting us on the spot there. I do like Batman on the Gargoyle. I do like that image a lot.
Well, you named one of mine, which was Jim Lee, Batman and Robin swinging over the city, which I think is the cover of All-Star Batman number one.
Mm-hmm.
I love that one. So, that's up there as far as like favorite Batman images. It's just like the Jim Lee Batman Hush where he is standing up there and the cape is kind of swooping around him. That's another really good one. On film, I'm a sucker for the final shot of Batman 89 where he's standing there against the sky with the bat signal. Yeah.
I will say in terms of comics, probably one of my favorite images is my cover of the Dark Knight Returns trade where he's... it's basically just he's all black, but he's like sitting on the wire, just like kind of hunched over. I don't know what it is. I just really love that image a lot.
Mm-hmm. All right. Nice. All right. Next question here is from Kevon Merrill. It says, with Gotham ending soon, what would your preference be for another Batman TV show? I think a show about Bruce's time spent traveling the world and training as a young man would be cool. Or would you guys just want a straight up Batman show? What do you think, Jeremy?
I mean, I've always wanted a straight up Batman show. I think we are way past time for another Batman TV series or TV show, especially live action. You know, it's been since Batman 66. I mean, you can't really count Gotham. So, yeah, I mean, I've been waving that flag for a while. I would love to see a Batman live action TV series. You know, bring Batman back to the small screen.
Nice. Yeah, I mean, me too. Like, I like Bruce Wayne, but I like him best when he's Batman. So I don't want another young Bruce Wayne show. I want a full on Batman show. I know it probably ain't going to happen, but that is my preference. So, I wish they would just go for it. I'd be all for it. Or a Bat Family show, even better.
I mean, I would say, you know, given the history, I would say now would probably be our best chances of it happening, just with the superhero genre being as big as it is and, you know, all these heroes getting, you know, on the small screen and the big screen. You know, Superman's coming back to the small screen. I mean, I know the argument of why WB doesn't have Batman on the small screen other than animated, or like you said, if it's, you know, a young Bruce Wayne, but I don't think it holds water anymore. Like, Batman movies are still going to make money, you know, whether he's on the small screen as well. So I just don't get it. You know, why wouldn't you take a chance and make a really good Batman series, especially with WB, as good as they've been doing on the small screen? Like, why wouldn't you bring out your heavy hitter and create a Batman series?
I know. I all the fans are with it. I just, you know, waiting for that to happen. Mm-hmm. All right. It looks like you found the kitchen.
Yes, I did. In my Google search, I just typed in DC the kitchen, and I found a comicbook.com article.
I typed in Batman the kitchen, and I just came up with silly photos of people dressed as Batman in their kitchen. So that did not work out for me, so I'm glad you did. So it looks like it is some sort of... it's like less superhero-y. It's like Mob Wives in Hell's Kitchen. So I'll go back to my original statement, which is I have not read it. I'm not familiar with it. But now that, you know, apparently there is a film in development, I'm intrigued by it, and it's something I'll have to check out.
Yeah, I'm seeing, just skimming through the article, I am seeing that Melissa McCarthy looks like she's attached to it. Which is, yeah, that seems to be the big name that I'm seeing on here.
Interesting. So, yeah, I'm interested to learn more about it. So, sorry we didn't know that, but hey, glad we found it. Next message here is from Adam Padrone. It says, you guys should do an episode on Jeff Loeb and Tim Sale's Haunted Night. There's still time. It's such a good read. Adam, I agree with you. But there is not still time to do it before Halloween. Not for me, anyway. So I apologize. Maybe next year. next question's from Mick Jameson. It says, gentlemen, would you prefer a younger Batman in a rebooted DCEU separate adventure or an in-his-prime Batman with a full Bat family and rogues gallery in a DCEU-related adventure? What do you think, Jeremy?
I mean, I'm assuming maybe he's talking about the Matt Reeves project that's coming up.
That would be my guess.
Yeah. You know, as much as I would go see a Batman origin movie over and over again, I feel like, you know, we could do without that. I mean, you could still obviously put the origin in there, but I think at this point, I think we could have a Batman movie that just drops us right into Batman in his prime, and I don't think anybody would bat an eye at it. You know, but BVS, we got, you know, an older Batman who's been around the block for a long time. So, I personally, you know, I would rather have a Batman in his prime. It does open up the door to bring in more characters, which, you know, I would like to think Matt Reeves is going to do. You know, like you mentioned, the Bat family, you know, I know we're all dying to see a Robin on the big screen again in some way, shape, or form. So I'm all for a Batman in his prime feature. That's where I would like to see it land.
Yep, I agree. Batman in his prime with the Bat family, with a established rogues gallery. Let's just do it. That would be my preference. And then Mick followed up with new Batman, your preference, John Hamm or Armie Hammer?
You know, I wasn't on the John Hamm bandwagon for a long time, but I gotta tell you, here lately, I'm starting to come around to it a lot. Me and my wife finally started watching Mad Men, so I've been getting a lot of him on that show. And then we just saw the Bad Times at the El Royale recently, and he stars in that. And I gotta tell you, I could definitely see him. I could definitely see him playing Bruce Wayne. And you know, that's half of the character right there. So, I mean, I think I would go with John Hamm.
I would go with Armie Hammer. I think John Hamm 10 years ago, sure. I think at this point, I'd go younger, Armie Hammer, get more movies out of him.
Yeah, that's a good point.
All right. And then there's the last one from Twitter. It's from Bob, Steve Bob 1984. It says, for Superman on film, if we were going to get a reboot, what would you want? And Batman Halloween movie, what would you want the villains to be and the story? So, all right, we'll start first. Superman reboot, what would you want?
Again, like, I don't think I need another origin story. I feel like we've gotten that a couple times now, you know, and even with Man of Steel, as much as I love that movie, and that is my Superman movie, you know, I was still holding my breath, hoping to see the next chapter of that version of Superman. So I want to see a Superman that's like we just talked about with Batman. I want to see a Superman who is Superman. I don't want to see another movie of Superman discovering himself or going on a journey to find himself in this place in the world. Like, I want to see Superman being Superman, duking it out with a, you know, a big bad, you know. I want a full-fledged Superman movie, without, you know, the undertones and, you know, this whole story of, you know, like I said, him going through a journey, because I feel like we just got that in Man of Steel and it was done really well. I love it, but I'm ready. I don't need to see Krypton destroyed again. You know, I want to see Superman being Superman.
For a Superman movie, I mean, I agree with you. Jump right in, established universe, but it is so overdue for Superman to take on Brainiac on the big screen. Mm-hmm. You know, we've had like how many Superman movies, and he's only ever taken on Zod and Lex Luthor. Brainiac, come on, bring it on, it's time. So that would be what I would want. As for a Batman Halloween movie, I mean, is that different from a Halloween special? for the movie, I don't know, then let's say it's Halloween night at Arkham Asylum, and the Rogues Gallery breaks out on Halloween night, and then the Bat Family has to spread throughout Gotham, taking them down one by one as they create Halloween chaos. How about that?
For me, I would, similar to you, I'm a big Arkham Asylum fan. I would love to see one set in Arkham Asylum. I would not want them to do the story that the Arkham Asylum game does, because it does kind of have a hokey ending climax to it. But I think Arkham Asylum is like the perfect setting for like a Halloween story. So I would take the part of the story though from the game where you have Batman in Arkham Asylum trying to deal with, you know, the inmates taking over the asylum, and then, you know, maybe he has to go through some type of mental journey, you know, maybe because of, you know, like in the game, you're dealing with Scarecrow and his gas and all these different elements brought in, and, you know, he's in the nut house. So you could definitely do a lot of scares and just, you know, Halloween theme it up. So, yeah.
So you want to keep it in Arkham, and I say get out of Arkham and go crazy.
I say keep it in Arkham, because I don't think we've spent enough time in Arkham in the movies yet.
That's probably true. All right, we're moving on to emails here. This one is from Bobby Hernandez. It says, hey, Andy and Jamie, I've got a question about Young Justice. I just finished watching it on DC Universe, and I loved it. Have you seen it? And if so, what did you think of the first two seasons? Bobby, you must be new here. I've been saying how great Young Justice is since this show began. It's one of my favorite animated shows of all time. I think it is so great. I think it is so sorely underrated. I'm so glad that people have discovered it because it's so good. And I am overjoyed that we're finally getting a third season. When I moved into my last place years ago, at this point it was like 6 years ago, I only got cable so I could watch Young Justice. That's how much I love it. So I'm glad you finally got to watch it. And for everybody out there who has not watched it, I'm glad it's on DC Universe for you to watch. Jeremy, please tell me you've watched both seasons of Young Justice.
I'm actually late to the party, but I have watched the first season. I actually discovered it through you guys, you know, just talking about it all the time. And then I found it on Netflix a while back. And I watched the first season, didn't get around to the second season. So I don't even know if it's still on Netflix. I doubt it. But I remember that's where I found it when I started watching it. So and I just so everybody knows, I don't have the DC Universe app yet. I am trying to find a way to fit it into my budget for another monthly streaming service. Maybe
it's
I
like
can just
$6, isn't it?
Right. $6. Is it $6 still?
I think.
Yeah, I guess I could give up a coffee.
That's a trip, yeah. It's not even two trips to Starbucks.
That's true.
It's one trip to McDonald's.
All right, I will sign up while we're recording. How about that?
All right, next question is from Matthew Malecki. It says, Andy, Jamie, I'm listening to your supercut of The Long Halloween, and I'm in the middle of reading Batman Eternal. Gave me an idea. Have either of you read Batman Eternal? Would you be interested in covering it as another long review for the show? I think it's a great candidate. It's a sprawling story that includes a lot of characters from Batman's cast. There's a lot to unpack and discuss. It's also a nice companion to The Long Halloween, as some characters and plot threads carry over. I don't know whether you guys are planning on doing another long review anytime soon, but I'd love to hear you review this book. I hope all is well. As always, keep up the great work. Love the show. Matt. Matt, thank you. Good to hear from you. Yeah, we haven't really talked about doing another long form review like that. And I did not read Batman Eternal. I read Batman and Robin Eternal. I just jumped to that one. Because Robin. One of these days I have to read Batman Eternal, but it's a good suggestion. I appreciate it. Jeremy, did you read Batman Eternal?
That's another one that was done by Scott Snyder, correct?
I think so.
I think I have that. My father-in-law actually bought me a DC subscription. So I've been getting a lot of issues in the mail. So I have like a nice stack of new Batman comics that I've been wanting to dive into, but just haven't gotten around to it. But I do feel like I saw Batman Eternal in that stack when I was getting them in the mail. So, yeah, I mean, I'm a Scott Snyder fan. I know some people aren't, but, you know, I liked a lot of his stuff with, you know, Death of the Family, the Court of Owls stuff I really enjoyed. So yeah, I need to check it out.
Sweet. All right, next message is from CJ Higgins. It says, hey guys, my question is for Jamie. What do you think of these shiny covers that DC started putting out? Also, did anyone else notice that Batman's outfit is back to the more classic design with the outside Speedo? Just me? Why was this not a big deal, like with Superman? And also, what are you currently reading or keeping up with? Anyway, keep up the great work and go Raiders. CJ Higgins. CJ, Jamie's not here, so I'm sorry. I'm sure he's listening, and he'll be able to answer your questions. But I like the cool, shiny covers, even if you didn't ask me. the trunks that are outside Batman's suit, I've never had strong feelings about those on Batman or Superman, so whatever. And currently reading or keeping up with? Nothing. They just keep piling up, and I haven't read a comic in at least a month. Unfortunately, that's just the truth of it. Next message is from Condor Zalander. It says, hey, Holy BatCast family, after watching Demolition Man and Judge Dredd with Sylvester Stallone back-to-back the other day, I have to ask you guys, would Sylvester Stallone have been a great Batman and Bruce Wayne? Number one, Demolition Man and Judge Dredd sounds like an awesome double feature.
I agree.
I support you, Condor, and I would join you for that. We would get Taco Bell, and we would have a wonderful time. As for whether he would be a great Batman, Jeremy, what do you think?
I don't see him being a good Batman, but I think there is a character out there for Sly, but obviously it was Judge Dredd, but people love or hate that one. But I don't know. I mean, part of me, I guess, could see it. I could see him in the cowl. I don't know if I could see him pulling off Bruce Wayne, but I could definitely see him pulling off Batman in some way, shape, or form, you know, maybe back in the day in his earlier years. I mean, honestly, even now, if you wanted to do a grizzlied up Batman, I mean, I could see Sly pulling it off, I guess, in the right hands.
That's nice. I love Sylvester Stallone. I love him. I don't think he would have been a good Batman. I can't picture it. He's wonderful, but he's only got a certain range, and I don't see that fitting with the character of Batman, and especially not Bruce Wayne. So as much as I love Sly, I think Sly was a good Judge Dredd, but I'm glad he wasn't Batman.
Maybe it's because the Judge Dredd helmet, you could just see his mouth kind of reminding me of the cow. I could see him in the cow.
Okay. All right. Cool. That's great. Next message here is from Destin Jeans. It says, "Hey, Andy and Jamie, loving the show and really got a kick out of my horrendous Jurassic Park question from the last email. So I decided to torture you with another totally unfair question. If you had to watch one of these two movies once a week, uninterrupted for the rest of your life, which would you pick? Batman Forever or Rob Zombie's Halloween? Can't wait for your response. Your longtime listener, Destin. P.S. Please don't ban me from emailing. Jamie is next." Well, Destin, yeah, time to torture Jamie. I agree. But he's not here this week. So, but yeah, you are just the Riddler, aren't you? Just giving me really hard and painful choices to make. Jeremy, I don't think you have as strong a feeling about these two films as I do.
Well, let me just say, I, you know, little behind the scenes, I have been going back and forth with Jamie, Tim Rooney, and Guy Milks on Facebook because they made a reference to the Rob Zombie Halloween on one of their most recent episodes of Please Rewind, and it was a joke about the Joe Grizzly scene in Rob Zombie's Halloween. I don't know if you remember that, Andy. I know you've tried to blank that whole movie from your mind, but it's basically the scene with the guy in the bathroom that Michael Myers kills in that movie. But I have been laughing hysterically all day with these messages that we've been sending back and forth. So I have a morbid curiosity right now to revisit Rob Zombie's Halloween just because I've been laughing so much at that scene. So
you shouldn't. Don't.
I guess I would have to go with Batman Forever just because there are more things in that movie that I can enjoy compared to Rob Zombie's Halloween. I mean, I like the Batmobile. It made my top 10 on my Batmobile, so that's something.
That is something. So between Batman Forever and Rob Zombie's Halloween, which would I choose? Death. I choose death. But if I'm giving a real answer, of course I'm going to pick Batman Forever. They're both garbage, but at least Batman Forever has Batman in it and Robin in it. I mean, I can deal with it despite its horribleness. Rob Zombie's Halloween is the cinematic equivalent of a roof tile scraped with feces. So yeah, Batman Forever, easy.
So somewhere down under, Brendan Lowe right now is saying he's cheering right now because you just got a win.
Yeah, I'd rather eat a cat shit sandwich than a dog shit sandwich. You're welcome. But thanks for the evil question. All right, next one here is from Jack Fiorillo. It says, "Hey, Andy and Jamie, it's my first email. I've got a few questions. Condiment King and Egghead are my two favorite Batman villains. Although it may sound like a ridiculous idea, I think Egghead and the Condiment King should team up in a Batman movie. What are your thoughts?" Second question, have you ever considered reviewing the Lego Batman game series? I think it would be a great idea with Lego DC supervillains coming out. Third question, have you ever considered reviewing the Legends of the Superheroes TV specials? They're now on DC Universe. Fourth question, okay, Jack, you're getting a little overzealous here. This is a question for RF for RM. Have you guys considered reviewing The Nightmare Before Christmas for its 25th anniversary? It's one of my favorite holiday movies. Sorry for the long message and keep up the great podcast, Jack. All right, let's do these one at a time. Condiment King and Egghead in a Batman movie. Jeremy, what do you think?
I would have to say if, you know, God rest his soul, if we were going to get another Adam West animated Batman movie, I would be all for that. The only other version of Batman where I could see those two being really good villains in is if we did a Brave and the Bold animated feature. I think those two would be a fun duo to have be the villains in that. Because I just feel like those two really fit with a certain version of Batman. And I think the Adam West Batman and the Brave and the Bold animated series Batman, I think, are the two versions I think that they would fit the best in.
Yeah. Is it ridiculous? Yes. Would I watch the hell out of it? Yes. In whatever medium it ends up in. Yeah, Egghead and Condiment King, heck yeah, I'd watch it. The tricky part for me is getting someone to follow up Vincent Price as Egghead. That, because Vincent Price was a legend, and that's a hard act to follow. I think there's someone out there who could do it. I don't know who it is off the top of my Egghead, but I know there's someone. I just don't know who it is. So that would be tricky. Second question, reviewing the Lego Batman games. We haven't thought about it, but I'm open to it. I do think I own them. I think I own at least the first one. I might own the first two. I'd have to check, but I'm open to it. Third question, reviewing the 1970s Legends of the Superheroes specials. Yes, this will happen. Take my word for it, especially because they're on DC Universe. And then The Nightmare Before Christmas for its 25th anniversary. I love that idea as well. We'll see if we could make it happen, but I agree with you. I love that movie, and I think it would be fun. So thanks, Jack. All right, next message here. It says, "Hey, Batcasters, Jonathan Tyler Patrick here with quick thoughts on the Superman show. All the characters are in place for a Superman show, you're right, but one thing that's worth mentioning is Metropolis, the show idea that was pulled from DC Universe with the intent of retooling it. I've said before, what would be awesome is a prequel series focusing on Lois Lane and the introduction of Tyler Hoechlin's version of Superman. Flesh out the world in which Superman will be a part of it. Tell of his adventures traveling the world. I think that could work. As always, love the show, Tyler." Tyler, thanks for the message. What do you think, Jeremy?
I mean, I'm not completely up to date with Supergirl, but, you know, he was introduced on Supergirl. So, I mean, I don't think you really need to, again, do like a backstory or an origin or anything like that. I think if the character has already been introduced into this world, like, why not just, you know, dive headfirst into it? I mean, you could always do things with flashbacks, you know, maybe not to the extent that Arrow did the first couple seasons, but you know, I think that would be the better route to go. Is, you know, we already know this Superman from the Supergirl series, so I just say you dive headfirst into it.
Tyler, I honestly forgot about the Metropolis show. I remember it was mentioned. It was like it was announced and then it kind of went away. I had forgotten about it. My guess is we won't hear much about it again. I could be wrong. Maybe it'll come back from the dead, but it seems like it is dead. A prequel series? No, I don't want to see Clark Kent wandering the world. I just want to see Superman. Same thing with the Bruce Wayne thing. I'm sorry. Give me Superman. All right. Next message here is from Jason Ritter. It says, Hi, Andy, Jamie, and Brendan, the Bat Kangaroo. I really enjoy the Titans reviews that you guys are doing. I was wondering what hero or villain would you like to see Slade face in the Deathstroke movie? Also, the Constantine animated one is out on Blu-ray just in time for Halloween. Trust me, Jamie, don't let the kids watch it. Anyway, have a good show from Jason Ritter. Thanks, Jason. Okay, who would you want Deathstroke to face off against in his own movie, Jeremy?
Is Nightwing a valid answer?
Sure. I mean, that's the best answer, but that's also what I wanted for the Nightwing movie. So I don't know if we just flip it and go, yeah, sure, Nightwing can be in the Deathstroke movie, too.
Is the Deathstroke movie actually happening still? Or?
Doesn't seem like it.
Yeah. I mean, if I had my pick, I would say Nightwing. And then at the same time, playing the Arkham Origins game, I would also like to see Batman square off against Deathstroke too, but that probably won't happen anymore, although it seemed like we could have got that at some point. But I would probably go Nightwing.
I mean, Nightwing is the correct answer, so good job. But it also feels like the easy answer. So if I were to go with someone other than Nightwing, I would say Deadshot. Get Will Smith back. Excuse me. Deathstroke versus Deadshot.
What if they? I mean, this is just thinking out left field, but you know, we know Suicide Squad 2 is in production, or not in production, but it's going to happen. You know, what if they introduce Deathstroke in the Suicide Squad films?
I think that would make perfect sense. There were certainly rumors that that was going to happen the first time.
Mm-hmm.
So this Suicide Squad 2 could be Suicide Squad versus Deathstroke.
I think that would make sense to me.
And that would be cool.
Yeah. Make that happen, James Gunn.
Yeah. Next message is from Jason Cohen. It says, how do you think that Christopher Nolan would have done Jervis Tetch the Mad Hatter? Do you think he would have hired the same actor from Gotham? No, he wasn't. He wouldn't have hired the same actor from Gotham. But how do you think he would have done him? Oh man, I have no idea. Any thoughts, Jeremy?
I feel like the Mad Hatter and the Riddler both would have been handled kind of the same way by Nolan. I feel like there would have been a lot of mind games, and I mean, obviously the two villains are not one and the same, but in Nolan's universe, I mean, he does tend to strip the villains down, and I could just see him using the Mad Hatter in the same way that he would use the Riddler, if that makes any sense. I don't know. I am curious, though. I mean, as much as I'm glad the Nolan movies, you know, had a conclusion, there are a lot of villains that I was curious about to see how he would handle them. And yeah, I mean, Mad Hatter is, that's one I never really thought of, but yeah, it would be interesting to see how he would have handled that character in his grounded universe.
Mm. So, I mean, you mentioned Gotham, and like I said, I don't think the actor is even up for debate, but I do think that Gotham found a way to do the Mad Hatter in a really interesting way that I think would have been more in line with probably what Nolan thought. Cause, you know, I'm not sure Nolan would have done the mind control by device or by technology, but doing mind control by hypnosis or influence or suggestion makes a lot more sense. And so I do think that it might've been something more along those lines.
Mm-hmm. Well, and we got kind of that with the Scarecrow. You know, he wasn't afraid to use the nerve gas with the Scarecrow. So, yeah, that would probably be the way he would approach it.
All right. Next message here is Stuart Busire. It says, hey, Andy, it's Stuart. I'm not sure if you've seen this yet. I was just watching the Geoff Johns panel from New York Comic Con. He was talking about when Ryan Potter got cast as Beast Boy. He said he auditioned to play Tim Drake when he was working on The Batman with Ben. I remember he put up a video trying to get the attention of Ben to play Robin, but nobody had confirmed he had actually auditioned for Robin, let alone Tim Drake, or that there was going to be a Robin in Ben's Batman movie. I'm surprised nobody picked up on this. I thought I'd message you before anyone else, as I know you're a massive Tim Drake fan. Here's a link to the video. Hope you're doing well and your body is managing to handle all the pumpkin goodness. Stuart. Stuart, always good to hear from you. Yes, I've started to turn into a pumpkin, which is very bad for my waistline, but I regret nothing. But honestly, I think Geoff Johns was just acknowledging the video that Ryan Potter did, and maybe he just didn't say it in quite the right way, because that video, you could say, was his audition video. Even though it wasn't prompted by Ben Affleck or Geoff Johns, Ryan Potter put together his own audition and put it out there into the world. So I think that's all he meant. I don't think he actually officially auditioned for Tim Drake in the movie. That's the way I read it anyway. I'm just glad that Ryan Potter became a official member of the family as Beast Boy.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's pretty well known now. I don't even think the Ben movie got that far to, you know, have auditions, I don't think. I mean,
right.
Could be wrong, but I seriously doubt it.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, next message here is from Julian Chan. It says, hey, Andy and fellow Bat Brothers. Like you guys, I'm very much enjoying Titans. It has far surpassed my expectations. I, too, loved Minka Kelly as Dove, and I think Brenton Thwaites is great as Dick Grayson / Robin. Here are my questions. Given that one of the episodes is titled Jason Todd, do we expect Dick's transformation to Nightwing by season's end? Number two, which costume would you like to see Donna Troy in? I suspect it will be the black one, but I hope it's the red one. And three, what other Teen Titan members would you like added to the roster next season? I'm old school and would like to see Wally, Roy, and Garth, but I'm not optimistic about that. That's it. By the way, I'm in Australia too, so if you could send me a tape of episode 3, that would be great. Betamax, please, and please rewind. Cheers, Julian. Well, thanks, Julian. Great. All right, questions. Number one, do you think that Dick's going to become Nightwing by the end of the season, Jeremy?
Well, as I mentioned, I don't have the DC Universe app, so I am not up to date with Titans.
You're not watching it.
I'm not watching it. I am like Brendan Lowe, only it's actually in my hands to do something about it, but I just haven't done it yet. But
that's even a bigger insult to Brendan, is you have the option and you're still not doing it. He's fighting tooth and nail to just have the option, to just have the opportunity. You've got the opportunity and you're throwing it away.
Truth be told, that's actually why I'm doing it. But, you know, I am excited to check out Titans, though. It is one of the big reasons I really do want to get the DC Universe app, because I have liked all the trailers I saw. I did hear you guys cover the first episode on here, and it looks the way I would, you know, have been waiting for a DC Universe show to look, as much as I like the CW stuff. But I'm really looking forward to checking it out. Like I said, I haven't watched it yet, but you know, if you're asking me if I think that they will bring Nightwing in by the end of it, I hope not. I mean, I would rather see us have Robin, you know, for a couple seasons before we dive into him becoming Nightwing personally.
Okay. I do think he's going to make that transition. I do. I don't know if it'll be at the end of this season. They might just tease that transition at the end of the season to make you come back for season 2. But yeah, I think it's happening. What costume would you like to see Donna Troy in?
I would probably go with the black one.
So would I. I mean, when you say Donna Troy, Wonder Girl, I think of her in the black. That's just where my brain goes. And so I agree. And then other Teen Titan members, I'm actually with you. I'm old school. I'd love to see Garth, Roy, and Wally in that order. Especially because we've already had Wally and Roy in the Arrowverse. So I wouldn't hold my breath for them. But Garth, heck yeah. But I'd welcome any of them. Any other Titans?
I mean, the obvious choice would be Cyborg, but I don't see that happening. At least from what I've seen of this version, I don't know if a Cyborg would fit in this universe.
Well, he's going to be in Doom Patrol.
Well, that's true. Yeah.
So if this is, and this does take place in the same universe as Doom Patrol, so I think you're going to at least see Cyborg
crossover. At least get like a crossover. Yeah. I would probably go with Wally as well. That's who I would like to see.
Sweet. Next message from Jay Yaws. It says, "Hey guys, this may have been asked before, but I have a feeling that the old Elseworlds imprint will have a resurgence in popularity after this year's CW crossover. In that vein, what are some of your favorite Elseworlds stories, and what kind of alternate reality stories would you like to see your favorite DC characters in? We've had Batman as a Green Lantern and Superman as Batman, and characters inserted into various historical conflicts like the Civil War, so the possibilities are endless. A world where Solomon Grundy and Gorilla Grodd are the world's finest, a reality where Blue Devil leads the Justice League? Let's get nuts. Baddiest of regards, Jay." Jay, I like your thinking, man. I agree with you. I think that there will be some attention around Elseworlds after the crossover. Blue Devil leading the Justice League is really all we need. That's the best thing. Man, I don't... Gosh, this is a big question, and I don't know. I have not prepared anything. But it does remind me of... Did you see the little reveal of the Elseworlds crossover that happened this week, Jeremy?
I did not.
Oh, it's so cool. John Wesley Shipp, The Flash from 1990.
Yeah. I did see that photo, yeah.
Yeah. Again, I'm like, aw, that's kind of spoilery. But literally every member of the cast shared a different photo of him. So I'm like, I guess it's not a spoiler. I guess they're using it to build buzz instead. But yeah, John Wesley Shipp is suiting up in the old 1990 Flash costume for the Elseworlds crossover. And it's amazing. And he looks amazing.
Yeah, I did see that photo. That's something I've been wanting since he came back onto the Flash. I've been wanting to see that. So, yeah.
They're awesome. I love that they're doing this. Mm-hmm. Anyway, favorite Elseworlds stories. I mean, I can't pretend to have all those like in my back pocket. I do like Gotham by Gaslight. I'd be all for the Red Rain Batman. Like, make that a movie. As far as like if I was just making up an Elseworld, man, I don't. Ooh, I have no idea. It's asking a big pitch.
I mean, I'm a big fan of, like you said, Gotham by Gaslight. I do like Red Sun. I know that one gets thrown around on here a lot. Those are the two big ones. I mean, I would literally have to look up some to... Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. Anyway. It will be. It's fun to think about. Next message here is from Philip Barker. It says, "Hey guys, I hope all is well during this happy Halloween season. Thanks for your wonderful recommendations on the DC Universe app. I've had a ton of fun reading a lot of old issues. I've been keeping up on Titans, and I gotta say, I'm really digging it. My question to you is, if Jason Todd is set to appear somewhere down the line, Do you think eventually Tim Drake will make his way to Titans as well? Tim Drake is one of my favorite characters, but I also think one of the best relationships he's ever had is with Dick Grayson. I could definitely see his character coming in at some point, maybe even to even be the bridge that brings Bruce and Dick back on better terms. Would love to know your thoughts. Keep up the great work, Bat Brothers, Philip Barker. P.S. Those Walmart giant-sized books are the bomb. Philip, always good to hear from you, brother. Tim Drake on Titans, what do you think?
I mean, I'm all for it. I mean, I love the Tim Drake Robin. I mean, I guess it would, from what you said, it sounds like we're going to move Dick into the Nightwing role. So, I mean, I'd be all for it, but I do feel like, I feel like Batman would have to have a stronger presence in the story if you were going to do that, in my opinion, anyway. I don't know. What do you think?
I mean, I think it's already a big deal that they're getting not Tim Drake, Jason Todd. Like, it's already a big deal that they've got a live-action Jason Todd in this show, and it in the show, Jason Todd is current Robin.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think you're going to have to jump forward a bit before you get to Tim Drake. Mm-hmm. Could happen if Titans goes for five seasons, you know, maybe in a few years, they do write it in that, you know, Dick Grayson hears of the death of Robin. And then a couple years after that, then Tim Drake shows up. So certainly it's possible, but I don't think it would happen anytime soon. I would love it to, because I agree with you. I think Tim and Dick's relationship are awesome, or is awesome. I just wouldn't expect it anytime soon. But yeah, if the show goes long enough, there's certainly opportunity for that.
I mean, do you see them bringing the Red Hood in at some point? I mean, with the Jason Todd being a part of the show?
I mean, that would even be further down the line.
Yeah.
Because you, like, Jason Todd is Robin right now.
Mm.
So you got to kill him. You got to let him be dead for a while, and then you got to bring him back. So, like, again, that's so far down the line, I wouldn't hold my breath for it.
Mm-hmm.
You could speed it up if you wanted, but I feel like that takes a lot away from it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, next message here is Jesse Willis. It says, hey, Holy BatCast family. After I heard about Santa Claus the movie in the last episode, this question came to me. What if Christopher Reeve as Superman and Helen Slater as Supergirl were in Santa Claus the movie, which could have been Superman and Supergirl helping Santa save Patch at the end of the movie? Interesting fact, Santa Claus the movie director Gino Zwark was also the director of Supergirl, which has a tie-in with both movies and could have been the start of a cinematic universe. Now, Jeremy, have you taken the plunge into Santa Claus the movie yet?
I actually revisited it recently, but I saw it when I was a kid as well. So I knew of the movie, and I have seen it a couple times. So yes.
Okay, because, you know, it is my personal goal in life to get as many people to watch that movie as possible.
Well, fun fact, I believe the actor that plays Santa Claus in Santa Claus the movie also plays the Big Lebowski in the Big Lebowski, if I remember correctly.
Indeed he does.
Yeah.
So I've got to say this. A couple episodes ago, someone brought up Santa Claus the movie, and I was like, oh, yeah, that is the Big Lebowski. It's Tom Huddleston.
Mm-hmm.
And it's David Huddleston.
Oh.
My brain mashed up Tom Hiddleston,
yeah.
And David Huddleston, and I made Tom Huddleston, and someone tweeted me and was like, Andy, you said Tom Huddleston? And I was like, oh my god, I did say that, didn't I? I misspoke. Yes, David Huddleston plays Santa. Should Superman and Supergirl have shown up in Santa Claus the movie? Yes, of course they should have. Duh. I did know Gino Zwark did Supergirl, and he did Santa Claus, and he did Jaws too. And he did Somewhere in Time, and he directed a bunch of episodes of Smallville. I like that guy. I think he's talented and often doesn't get a lot of credit. But yeah, I mean, it would have blown my little geek brain to see Superman and Supergirl show up in Santa Claus. Mm-hmm. Santa and Superman and Supergirl teaming up to save Christmas. Maybe if they had made a sequel. I can only imagine how wonderful that would have been.
Well, I mean, they've always kind of, and, you know, granted, those movies were made around the same time, so maybe that's part of it, but at least for me, they always had the same look to them, so you could say they're part of the same universe anyway.
I know. So Supergirl was 84, mm-hmm. and Santa Claus was 85, so they were back-to-back.
Mm-hmm.
Those Salkins love Gino's work. All right, next message here is from Chris, the objective geek. How objective. It says, hey, Andy, Jamie, and B-Low.
That's a thing?
It is now. It says, double entendre nickname. You're welcome. Love the show. Every Batman fan should be listening to it. I agree. And since you're so objective, everyone should agree with you, too. It says, on to my question. Villain-centric movies like Suicide Squad and Venom were panned by critics. I really liked Suicide Squad, and I just enjoyed Venom, but both were box office hits. My question is in regards to the Joker movie. Does these movies' performances, despite lack of critical acclaim, the Joker movie being a villain movie, the talent behind the Joker movie, and the fact that it is a Joker movie get you thinking that the Joker movie will be big, maybe even bigger success? I think even if it's just an okay movie, it makes $600 million worldwide. Thanks for taking the question, Chris, the objective geek. Chris, thank you for the message. So, do we think it will be as big or even bigger than Suicide Squad and Venom? Jeremy, what do you think?
I mean, the Joker is going to put butts in the seats, regardless. I mean, that's a character that even the most casual fan knows, so I think you're going to get butts in the seat regardless. So, you know, you look at Suicide Squad and even Venom, I mean, those are two franchises that, you know, they have a, I don't want to say a small, you know, group of, you know, hardcore fans, but I mean, they're not, I wouldn't say that they're as well known to the general audiences as a character like the Joker. So I see this movie being successful. I don't know what the budget is offhand, but I would imagine it's not going to be crazy. So I think just having a movie with the Joker in it is probably going to make the budget back pretty easily. And I personally, I mean, unless this thing is just a complete dumpster fire, which I don't think it will be, I think it's going to be a pretty big hit at the box office, in my opinion.
Yeah, the budget is only $55 million, which is not a low, low budget, but it's pretty darn reasonable. So, no, I think it's going to be successful. There aren't a lot of bad case scenarios for this movie with a $55 million budget. Mm-hmm. You know, do I think it'll do as much as Suicide Squad? Probably not. Suicide Squad did $750. That seems a little high. I could be wrong, but I don't think it'll quite do that. But Venom numbers, I think, is certainly possible, especially if it's good. You're right. The Joker brings a lot of attention. There's certainly buzz. There's good talent involved. So people are definitely interested. And if the trailers are great, then yeah, I could see it blowing up. Next message here is from Whistle Red. It says, greetings, Andy and the Holy BatCast family. Would Leonardo DiCaprio have been a great Tim Drake Robin in Batman Unchained? I remember hearing around 1998 that Tim Drake was supposed to make an appearance in the movie and become Robin in the next Batman movie after Batman Unchained, since Chris O'Donnell would have become Nightwing and would go on to have his own Nightwing movie. Leonardo DiCaprio was rumored for Tim Drake. Jeremy, what do you think?
So this is, what year was this?
This would have been 98, so after the year after Batman and Robin.
98. I'm trying to think where DiCaprio was at that point. 98. Because
that would have been right after Titanic, because Titanic was 97 too.
Ooh.
Which, number one, it's crazy to me that I just realized that Batman and Robin and Titanic were the same year, because I never thought about that before. But they are. Summer of 97 was Batman and Robin, and then Christmas of 97 was Titanic.
Wow. Man, I'm getting old.
Yeah, well, we all are.
I would say, given the time period, I would say no. But I could definitely see a younger DiCaprio maybe pulling off Tim Drake. But man, 1998 DiCaprio, I don't know. He just seemed a little too old for me to be Tim Drake, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm honestly glad you brought up the timing, because I didn't think about it. I just was like, mm-hmm. Oh yeah, Leonardo's great. He would have been awesome. And then I'm like, oh wait, he was already Titanic age. I agree with you. That seems a little old for me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think a couple years prior to this, he would have been a great Robin and a good Tim Drake. I always liked Leonardo DiCaprio. I think he's a great actor. But yeah, I think by the time 98 rolled around, he was number one king of the world, so he didn't need it. Yeah, he's probably a little older by then.
Let me just say, though, speaking of DiCaprio, I would love to see him in a comic book movie. I could really see him playing a really good villain, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, a lot of people wanted him for the Riddler for the longest time.
Oh, so. Yeah. That's actually who I was just thinking of.
Yeah, I could see it. Mm-hmm. All right, next message here is from Jason Miller. It says, what are your favorite Batman writers and favorite arcs? Also, who are your favorite Bat family members? Thanks, Jason. Jason, thank you. Favorite Batman writers? That should be an easy question, and I'm like, it's not so easy.
I mean, I have a couple of the heavy hitters right off the bat, but I feel like I would be doing a disservice to some other.
I would say Denny O'Neill. I would say Paul Dini. I feel like whenever Paul Dini writes Batman or his world, I like it. I mean, those are the two that jump out to me. Like you mentioned Scott Snyder earlier. Like, I like Scott Snyder, but I'm not like in love with Scott Snyder. Mm-hmm. I haven't been a huge fan of Tom King's. And I like a little more classic. I like the stuff that Denny did in the 70s and 80s.
Yeah, I'd probably agree. I think I would agree with you there. I mean, like I said earlier, I do like Scott Snyder. His stuff got me back into Batman comics. So I did like a lot of the stuff that he brought to the table. Obviously, I like most people, I'm a big Dark Knight Returns fan, so I do love Frank Miller stuff. I think I would agree with the ones that you suggested and the couple I just mentioned. I've never been a big Grant Morrison fan, even though I do own a couple of his, but I've never been a huge Grant Morrison fan, so.
Yeah, I'm not a huge Grant Morrison guy either. I like Jeff Loeb a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Loeb's done a lot of great stuff, so I'll throw him out there too. Hush is a favorite arc. That one's super fun. That's Jeff Loeb and Jim Lee. That's good stuff there. And favorite Bat family members, that's easy. Tim Drake, Dick Grayson, Barbara Gordon. Like, those are my three favorites of the Bat family. I mean, I pretty much like all the Bat family, but Tim Drake's number one. Dick Grayson is like almost right equal with Tim, and then Barbara. What about you, Jeremy?
I'm going to co-sign all three of those.
All right. Last email from Dave White. It says, hey, Andy, Jamie, and or Brendan, with regards to DC Films president Walter Hamada and all things DC on film, does the buck stop with him? I mean, do you think that the buck stops at Kevin Feige's feet? Do you think he reads every script and has hands on every facet of Marvel Studios? Or does he have trusted people beneath him who make the appropriate decisions? I just don't believe Hamada would have the time to have his hands on every decision, large or small, but maybe he has the final say. What do you guys think? Have a good one, Dave. Dave, thank you for the message. Jeremy, what do you think about this?
I mean, I in terms of Marvel, I do think Kevin Feige has a lot of control over there. I think that's why there's been so much consistency in terms of, you know, love it or hate it. But, you know, the way that universe has been constructed, I think there has to be a common thread through that universe. And I think Kevin Feige is that thread that's, you know, kind of kept that thing going the way it's been going over there in terms of, you know, continuity and, you know, the tone of that universe. So, I mean, I would like to think that he does have that over at DC, but I don't know. I'm not sure. I think until we start seeing some of these newer features coming out, I mean, I don't really know for sure.
Yeah, I mean, we haven't seen any movies that came from the new Hamada regime yet.
Yeah.
So you're right. We don't really know. My guess is for Marvel, do I think the buck stops with Kevin Feige? Yes. Mm-hmm. Does he have like his lieutenants who help execute what he wants? Absolutely. But I think that there is a reason for the consistency of the Marvel Studios films. And I think that reason is Kevin Feige.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, like I think that is accurate over there. I think it is a more producer driven studio where Feige oversees everything creatively, and that's why those movies do seem to consistently feel similar, if you will. Not completely. Like, don't email me and be like, oh, but this doesn't feel like this. I know, but you know what I mean. Like, there is just a certain, there's certainly a feel of a Marvel Studios film that's consistent. I think that's because Feige's hands are always on each movie, and I think that's not a bad thing. But I don't necessarily think that's going to be true with Walter Hamada. It just seems like, even looking at Joker, I mean, I think Joker happened under the Hamada regime, and it seems like he's like, hey, Todd Phillips pitched this. I liked it, so I'm letting him make it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's only $55 million. So if it doesn't work, who cares? So I think that, you know, they are still going with a more filmmaker-driven approach. I know that in the past, they said they did that and haven't done it. Again, I know that. I'm aware. but I do think that is still the goal. And I think that Hamada's background from New Line was to let the filmmakers make their movies, but just at much more reasonable budgets, so that way the whole farm isn't riding on every movie. And I think that whether or not the buck stops with him, I think he is still just more prone to giving the filmmakers a little more leeway to make their film than like a Kevin Feige would, who I think Kevin Feige is just a lot more involved.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think they're starting to still try to figure out how to make that work over at DC and Warner Bros. Because I know that's been their goal all along, is to have a filmmaker-driven, studio over there with the DC films. But I think, you know, especially with Wonder Woman, you know, I think that they're still trying to figure that out to make that work. I think that there, it looks, at least from what we're seeing on the ones coming out soon, I think they're starting to get that, get it right, I think, in my opinion. I mean, we'll have to see with Aquaman and Shazam, but I think Wonder Woman was definitely the start of making that work the right way for them. I've given up. I don't want to say given up because that sounds bad, but you know, in the beginning, I wanted a DC universe cinematically the way we have with Marvel. I really wanted that, you know, cinematic universe that, you know, connects, you know, all things are connected and all that, just because, you know, I am a fan of the DC characters, and I love the Marvel Cinematic Universe and what it's brought to the screen. So I definitely wanted to see that with DC, but you know, I'm all for, given, you know, what we've seen so far and, you know, the ups and downs, like, you know, I'm all for them, you know, trying to do things a little differently than Marvel. I think, going to, you know, the lengths that they did in the beginning, trying to, you know, call it what you will, but almost felt like they were trying to catch up with Marvel, you know, and there were some mistakes made and things like that. But I think they're starting to right the ship, and I think they're gonna take DC films in a little different direction than what Marvel's doing over there at Marvel Studios. And at this point I think that's a good thing. I'm looking forward to seeing what they do differently at DC.
Cool. All right. Yeah, I mean, I think that in the past, I think the past, when they have tripped up, it's because they didn't trust their filmmakers, and now it's time to walk the talk, and I hope that that is the strategy that Hamada employs. I think it will be best for everyone. All right, that's it for emails. We do have a couple voicemails, so let's check in those before we wrap this baby up. First email here is from listener Evan.
Hi, Andy. Hi, Jamie, and any other people who are there. I'm the same person who left the Scarecrow message last time. I realized I forgot to say my name. My name is Evan, and I was wondering how you guys feel about the Young Justice comics. I am okay with them, but I'm not a huge fan about the art style. So I was just wondering your take on them. Thanks for bringing us so much good content.
Well, thank you, Evan, and thank you for calling back. Good to hear from you. Young Justice Comics, I need to pick them up. I know that they just relaunched it. I saw some artwork that I thought looked pretty cool, but I haven't picked up any of the new issues yet. As I admitted earlier, very embarrassingly, I am way behind on all comic reading. So I will have to add that to my to-do list. Jeremy?
Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, I have a stack of Batman comics that I need to dive into, but next time I'm at my comic book store, I'll be sure to check out the artwork, though, to see what it looks like.
I mean, I'm a sucker for the team, so I'm willing to give them a shot. Mm-hmm. All right, another voicemail here. This one is from our pal Tim Rooney.
Hi, Holy Batcasters. It is Tim Rooney here. I'm just giving a call to say, hey, and I actually had a curious question. I was wondering, since Titans is out right now, and I have read some stuff for Robin and Nightwing solo, but haven't read Teen Titans story arcs. So I was curious, what trades do you recommend? And if there's, like, if you notice anything on the DC Universe app that I should be checking out to be reading along with the show, thanks again, and keep up the great work. Peace.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Rooney. Good to hear from you, too. Glad you're enjoying Titans. As far as arcs for the Teen Titans, I've been reading the Teen Titans book for years now, and I've really been enjoying it, both pre-rebirth and post-rebirth. There's good stuff in there. I was reading it pre-rebirth because it was the only place I could get Tim Drake. Oh, man, I can't think of specific arcs, but the good thing about DC Universe, and this is not a paid endorsement, is they highlight a bunch of issues to go, hey, these are going to be good and helpful right now. So I would take their recommendations. They have the entire introductory run of Teen Titans from like the 80s, and I've read a few of those already on DC Universe, and those are great. So I'd give those a shot. That's still when Dick Grayson is Robin. Of course, you got to read the Judas Contract because that's when he becomes Nightwing. Other than that, yeah, I would just go to the Titans section of the DC Universe app and just go crazy. Binge read instead of binge watch.
Yeah.
Jeremy, anything to add?
I would just say it sounds like I need to do that as well, so...
Well, first you have to sign up for DC Universe.
I'm working on it. I will send you the screenshot when I do it.
All right. Anyway, thank you guys for those voicemails. Always good to hear from you. If you would like to send us or leave us a voicemail, you can do that at 323-366-9246. But that is where we're going to wrap up this episode of Holy BatCast. Jeremy, number one, for all you folks out there, thank you guys for giving us so much to talk about. This ended up being a pretty long episode because you guys had so many questions, but thank you for that. And Jeremy, thank you for making the time to join me for this episode.
It's always a pleasure to get the call, so I look forward to it.
Sweet. And if the folks at home want to keep up with you or listen to your show, where can they do that?
Well, if there are any Bat fans out there who like horror and are Stephen King fans, I have my own podcast called Dark Tower Radio, where, like Holy BatCast, we cover all things Stephen King. So we talk about books, comics, movies, TV miniseries, you know, all facets of the Stephen King world. So recently, me and Guy Milks, who is a regular co-host over there, we did a episode on Children of the Corn for the Halloween season. So we just did that, and I just did my first commentary track ever, where I revisited the Dark Tower movie 1 year later to see if it still is not as good as I remember it. And spoilers, it still was not very good. But
sad.
But, you know, if you're into Stephen King and want to find a Stephen King podcast similar to the way Holy BatCast does things here with Batman, come check us out.
Excellent. Please do. I already told you guys where to find me. You can also hear me on Disorder, every Disney film. If you love hearing me talk about nerdy things, you can do that. But yeah, that is where we're going to wrap up this episode of Holy BatCast, an episode all about you. And I guess just by default, our Halloween episode, even though it wasn't very Halloween-y, I apologize. At least you guys delivered some Halloween questions, which allowed us to talk a little bit about Halloween, and I appreciate that. But thank you guys for downloading the show. Please do subscribe to the show on iTunes. Please rate and review us on iTunes. And as Michael Keaton's Batman says, I want you to tell all your friends about me. Visit holybatcast.com. Find Holy BatCast all over social media on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Just search for Holy BatCast. If you've got a question or a comment for the Wayne Manor mailbox, you can email that to holybatcast@rf4rm.com, or you can leave us a voicemail at 323-366-9246. But that'll do it for this episode. On behalf of Jeremy, as well as Jamie, who's too lazy to show up, as well as Brendan, who's too lazy to show up, I've been Andy, as always. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time, same bat channel, but most importantly, have a batty Halloween.
Holy BatCast is brought to you by real fans for real movies. Remember, the thoughts and opinions shared by the participants are theirs and theirs alone, and do not represent the companies or organizations they happen to work for.
Allen, a normal guy, got hit by a bolt of lightning, giving him superpowers, making him the Flash. Come on, that's cool.
So you're fast.
That feels like an oversimplification.